Welcome to today's session on the Mint Think Tank. We've all witnessed a whirlwind year, and for the retail industry, nothing has been more disruptive than the pandemic, which has pushed many companies to relook at every aspect of their business. As consumer habits shift globally, retailers across categories have had to adopt. Those offline have had to build better digital capabilities, while online retailers have had to improve the speed at which they reach shoppers and widen the distribution, assortment, and warehousing capabilities. In such a scenario, technology has been the common binding thread fueling multiple businesses. Grocery retailers dealing with the surge in orders, or fashion stores turning to omni-channel capabilities amid intermittent lockdowns, the use case for tech has only been amplified in a post-COVID world. Today's session on Mint Think Tank is aptly titled Rewriting the Retail Story Through Innovation. We welcome our excellent panelists who join us to talk about how they are leveraging technology to engage and deliver in a post-COVID world. I would now like to introduce our guests for the evening. We have Mr. Joydeep Bhattacharya, Head of the Retail and CPG Practice in Bain India. Welcome, Mr. Bhattacharya. We have Ms. Uma Talreja, Chief Marketing and Customer Officer, E-commerce and Omnichannel at Shoppers Stop. Hi, nice to have you here, Uma.
Thank you.
Mr. K. Yashas, Regional Vice President at Salesforce. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Arun Jayaraman, Head of Marketing at Big Basket. Then we have Mr. Pratap Swaroop, Chief Financial Officer at Bestseller India. Welcome, Mr. Swaroop. And Mr. Sirish Agarwal, Head of Marketing at Panasonic India. Welcome, everyone. Thanks so much for joining in for this virtual session. So 2020 was really a very tough year for all of you. It really took you all by surprise. Most of you were caught, off the guard. With the second wave now hitting, I want to understand from each of you individually, how prepared were you when it came to really up and running a business? And what were the key learnings? So we'll start with you, Joydeep. Just wanted to understand how important is it for retail and CPG companies to really understand the consumer in today's world, engage with them and deliver on brand promises, especially as consumer patterns, shopping behaviors are completely shifting. Over to you.
No, firstly, Sunira, thank you for inviting me to the panel, and I look forward to a thoughtful discussion with my co-panelists. The question that you asked, Sunira, I mean, there's always been a need for, better consumer understanding and, putting that into the brand. And I would say there are two imperatives that I see, my clients pursuing. One is there is always a case for doing, more and doing, the same things better, right? So it's looking harder and smarter at data, whether it's from transactions, whether it's from, what your peers, et cetera, are doing. But I think, with the speed of change, I would see there are three big shifts that we are at least seeing, leaders in the market try and do. Number one is just far more test and learn, right? So there is no way that any research in the world will tell you how consumers will react. And we are still pretty early in terms of how consumer behaviors are shaping up. So a bunch of kind of test and learn capabilities is what we see, the best CPGs and retailers try and develop. Second is to do kind of, just better listening. So, whether that's social listening, there are other methods, not just listen to what consumers are telling you about your brand, but about your peer brands as well. So just up the game in terms of listening. The third one I would say, and I think that's given the nature of this change, is to do just much better contextual research. As I see across categories, consumers are evaluating choices, not just within the narrow frame of, how you may define your category, but across categories as well. So just better contextual research is what would help. That said, Sunira, I think there are some given trends or changes which, again, the best, of retailers would, continue to pursue, whether that's more personalization, more casualization, moderation, value consciousness. These are trends that, I think, all players, and all panelists here recognize are going to be there for the 20s, right? They could have got accelerated in some cases, they could have got subdued. But the big shifts is, again, what we see, clients kind of, making sure that they understand those big consumer shifts around personalization and make sure that they are kind of, pursuing those.
Great, thanks. And Jyoti, just wanted to understand, you know, what all categories has this touched really in the last 1 year? Has this left anybody, I mean, who was better prepared, ill-prepared? If you could just give me an overview of the categories that you worked on or the clients that you've, you know, recommended things to.
Yeah, so Surya, the question is, you know, how did we react in the second wave compared to the first one? I think, you know, as I think it was probably Mark Twain who said that, you know, history never repeats itself, it just rhymes. And I think parts of when the second wave rhymed with the first, you know, players were prepared. Whether it was QSR or lifestyle players, they had the right playbooks to ensure business continuity, to maintain, you know, safety, hygiene, you know, use more online channels. So there were a bunch of things that kind of, you know, were learned from the first wave and taken on to the next one. I think also making sure that most of the organization was working on, you know, pre-decided priorities rather than everybody scurrying around. So a smaller team, you know, really rolled out the response. But I would say that, you know, and I would love to hear how my co-panelists kind of react. There were three big changes in which way I think the second wave has not rhymed with the first. Number one, I think that the nature of demand is quite different. I think issues of around safety, the need to save has actually crowded out, you know, overall spending. And I think it's going to take a longer time to come back than one may have thought when we were in the first wave. Second, I think commodity price increases. I think that's kind of, you know, wasn't really there in the first wave. And therefore, that's either impacted gross margins or it's impacted demand where we've taken on price increases. And the third one, I think, in which way the second wave has been different is that this time the impact of COVID has been far more widespread and far more proximate. You know, every CEO that I know has spent time worrying about, you know, vaccinating not just their teams, but those families, you know, comforting ones with losses. So I think that nature of that, you know, of the CEO agenda has been quite different, you know, this time around. So those are the three big changes that I see around demand and, you know, the commodity price impact, and that's going to stay for a while, and how really some of the people agendas have changed.
Sure. You know, how can retailers leverage new age tech tools to not only provide great experience to customers, but also shorten their recovery cycle? Because clearly, from the larger organized retailers to even the small kirana stores, all have been impacted by this. So, you know, what are the tools available to them? What all have you worked on in the last 1 year, of course, and going to the second wave now as we speak?
So, Sunera, I think more than, you know, looking at the context of what can retailers do, you know, to react to some event like this, I think it's the longevity of, you know, what an event like this actually does to our business, to our lives, and to the lives of consumers that we support as businesses, right? So some of our customers, for example, have been faced with decisions that are, you know, completely new in the context of their business over the life cycle. So, you know, a 20-year-old business is now faced with a decision of, should I be looking at a digital channel as being, you know, a P&L in itself? Should I be investing in, you know, creating a completely new way for customers to engage with us? For those customers, you know, for those businesses that have already had some level of digitization, I think the need to speed up the level of, you know, technology input into their day-to-day engagement with customers has actually been impacted quite significantly in this cycle, right? Two things come to my mind, you know, in the conversations we've had with our customers who are thinking through this whole digitization and adoption of technology. One of them is that, you know, it has come down to the quality of the data that's available to them. So the quality of decisions that they're making with respect to the business are directly linked to the quality of decision data that's available to them, right? And the challenge that many of our customers today are facing, you know, or businesses in the retail CPG sector are facing is that this data is spread across a huge variety of sources, right? So some of it is in legacy systems. Some of it actually happens to be in your channel partner ecosystem. And, you know, the data also has different classifications, such as, you know, the sensitivity of it. You know, a simple example of something that has come to the fore because of us going all digital in our purchasing cycle is the, you know, the family unit. More people leverage the same, you know, customer profile, the account, to actually carry out transactions on behalf of a household, which is very, very different from when, you know, you had individual people from a family walking into a store, right? So I think the importance of this data is something that has come to the fore in this recent period. And as a corollary to that, you know, the ability to integrate all the different sources from where you're actually surfacing up this data, your own, you know, purchase patterns, your consumers' buying preferences, the channels that they typically use to engage, you know, with you, as well as some of these data input elements like, you know, the family construct, all of these, the ability to integrate these. So I think most of the deployment of tech in this period has gone towards solving that problem of integration, Sunira, as well as availability. You know, do you have the availability to engage with customers where they want to engage with you and when they want to engage with you? And secondly, do you have the ability to integrate all these data sources to support better decision-making for you?
Right. Just a follow-up to that, sir. Just how does it vary when it comes to larger traditional companies who have more offline businesses versus those that are more new age, sort of new to the digital economy? You know, how do you see the way they handle and sort of mine data? Is there a difference? Have offline companies also become more mature when it comes to using data?
I think with companies that have had more traditional offline businesses, Sunira, the key question for them to answer has been, where do I start, right? What portion of the data should I focus my attention on? Should I be looking to, you know, leverage what I have gathered over a period of time? Should I be looking to leverage trends that are more recent? For instance, the buying patterns, as Mr. Bhattacharya was pointing out, are probably very distinct in this past 2 year period, wave one and wave two, compared to, you know, how traditionally consumers have engaged with some of these large offline retail organizations. So that decision point on where to start becomes probably the biggest factor for them to look at, what data should they actually prioritize, right? The next part of it is also, how fast can I go to market with it? The challenge that many of the traditional companies have is that, large scale tech innovation has traditionally meant, you know, a period of 6 months, a period of a year or longer periods in order to, fulfill and complete what you're actually going to market with. How do they actually shorten that cycle to possibly a 3 month cycle, a 4 month cycle? How do they pilot some of these initiatives possibly for a select set of customers, select set of geos, or even a select set of offerings that they have, right? So I think these are the two aspects that the larger, more traditional companies have had to deal with, keeping in mind that, you know, they don't have the ability to disrupt what has already been in place over a period of time.
Great, thank you. Uma, coming to you, interesting, because again, offline retail play, of course, omnichannel playing a great role in what you're doing. If I'm not mistaken, I think for Shoppers Stop, for the fourth quarter of FY21, omnichannel sales were almost upwards of 6% for you, which is quite interesting coming in a second year of COVID. So really, you know, what have you done differently in the past year? What learnings have you taken for the number to be as it is? And as Joydeep mentioned, and as Mr. Yashas mentioned, a lot of personalization, a lot of sort of, looking at digital channels as separate P&Ls. Is Shoppers Stop looking at that very closely now, specifically in 2021?
I think our digital channels have, of course, gotten much more focus, which is a natural outcome of the pandemic. But I think the way we have looked at it is, I'll add to what Joydeep said, right? Everybody's faced with an angle where you want to help others in the second wave, right? So how do you actually create assistance, which is for your employees, and also motivate them, because, you know, they are there to actually sell. How do you use digital to help them? And how do you actually make it easy for customers to really shop during the pandemic? And it's more about actually a reserved approach to actually push sales. However, it is more about creating assistance. So I think that has been one big pivot that we have actually taken during the pandemic for sure. So the channel that we have primary focus, of course, on is shopperstop.com, where we have been consistently building it for scale, right? So right now we are, I think, pre-COVID to now, we would be at almost three times of where we were in terms of sales. But here we have actually focused on making sure that our back end is sorted, right? And we are focusing on improving the front end experience continuously for customers to be able to actually use the channel well when they're shopping from home. And this is then augmented and helped by actually a effort on assisted sales on shopping from home. So we have more than 300 personal shoppers and probably the only retailer who have personal shoppers who then uses the online channel to actually serve customers who are sitting at home. So we have not encouraged people to come to the store, and that's a very bold way of operating, where we have actually not driven footfalls consciously, but driven the digital channel very, very actively. The second thing we did is we launched a service in this time, which is called White Glove, which is more for our premium customers in terms of both assistance as well as catalog selling through WhatsApp and through chat, which you can do directly with a sales staff, or you can actually approach it through shopperstop.com, which is the digital channel itself. So I think that's the second piece. And there's a lot of talk, I think, about data. And I think here I would say it's very important to look at your segments very carefully, because consumer behavior has completely changed, right? And we all know that there are people who look for premium product, there are people who look for value, there will be people who look for maybe more fashion, etc. But I think that the behaviors that have emerged forces you to look at segments very differently and then see what people could need, and is your catalog and your marketing matched to that. So for example, there could be a work from home segment, right? And that could be a very dominant segment in terms of saying work from home, who's also working on video. But there could be frontline, you know, segments which are forced to sit at home, who are more like tired homemakers probably today, right? And that could be a segment which could be both ways. It could be people who are now sitting at home, not really working. And then there are others who are actually working doubly hard to manage a home. There could be segments which are around, you know, kids who are schooling from home, etc. So, and I guess a common thread of wellness, which then ties this all together, because that's the biggest theme that has emerged. How do you use these segments? How do you evolve it? Someone, Salesforce spoke about the starting point. I think we have a point where we are already there, right? And we have already created profiles and we have created segments. How are they emerging in the current context, right? And then how do you keep shaping these segments more dynamically as you learn more and more about consumers? And I think this is a two-pronged approach. Look at your data in terms of what you've got, in terms of a footprint of the customer, as well as, which is of course browsing behavior, what do they respond to, what do they click on, what do they actually buy, the transaction data. But also I think it's important to have voice of customer in place at this point in time to ask people what they would like. And I think that we use very well through our frontline network, right? So, I mean, of course there could be surveys, but because we have a huge interface with customers, which is more human in nature, using that for voice of customer, feeding that back into your data system. And we've actually looked at saying, how do we recreate our data architecture to actually incorporate and absorb this to evolve these segments? So I think those are the kind of initiatives that we have, of course, taken. And active marketing is now for us only digital. We don't actually operate any other marketing channels as of now. So right from acquisition to retention to also customer service and post sales, we are on, I think, 100% digital now, barring few instances where we will still have customers who want to obviously use a call center, etc. We are completely digital now.
Interesting. Uma, did you tweak anything which you started last year as you enter this year? Now you said customer feedback is very important. So have you done anything? Could you share any examples?
I think we have found, of course, that, you know, on digital, journeys do matter. I think that's the most critical piece. And we did run some research, which was first-hand research with users of our digital channel to identify pain points and also to identify what would create delights, and then have put some efforts underway on that. One of the big pieces is, of course, you know, because for us, customer relationships matter, and, you know, is very predominantly spoken by, of course, the relationship being named as the First Citizen, which is our loyalty program, but is more a relationship program than a rewards program for us. And I think that's where we are impacting the biggest change, because people wanted easy account management online. You know, this is a segment to birthday, anniversaries, coupons, their points, etc. do matter. How do you create assistance in that journey itself for them online is something that now, you know, we are working on. And recognition is something that we had worked on earlier, which matters to the pool of customers that we're talking about. So I think that's been a large focus area for the company, even when they were offline. And we do see a large base of our customers from that also shifting to online and using multi-channel. So that has been one of the changes that we have made in terms of looking at what matters to our First Citizens and how do we actually implement that into the online channel for sure.
Right. Uma, before I move to the next panelist, I would like to ask you, consumers also have some concerns around sharing data. Of course, they're inundated with so much of sort of digital shopping, so many subscriptions. How do you strike the right balance between saving customer data without breaching privacy? You know, you all have a very strong loyalty program. So how do you work around that?
I think the saving is not so difficult, Sunira, because you can save all kinds of data which you're allowed to save today. And we are not under that kind of governance also yet. I mean, except for payment and few other data. I think it's more important. I think two things are very important here. One is an opt-in is very important. And how you structure this opt-in is also now very important. So it's not just about having a tick box, which of course is compliance, But I think customers are interested in choice and preference, right? So the usage of this data can become far more powerful if you structure your opt-in correctly, right? And you co-opt the customer and you create buy-in into that process. I think that's a very critical step. The second, I think, is transparency, right? So how transparent are you with customers in terms of what data you are actually capturing, storing, and how you're going to use it, and how your privacy statement and, you know, covers that? So I think that's another important piece. So for example, we have a statement which says we are responsible for your data, and you know, have actually stated that upfront to consumers in a manifesto. And I think it's important because the data is the foundation of that relationship, and that needs to come with the trust. So every brand would have their own way of actually expressing that trust. But to me, these are the two things. How do you structure your opt-in, and how do you create that transparency of the usage and create buy-in in as many customers as you can? I think the issue comes is when you are actually using your data more from, you know, retargeting perspective, etc., which sometimes tends to get intrusive, right? So I think we do take conscious effort to not retarget in a way which is interruptive, right? I think if you are going to be watching your favorite television program, which is a murder mystery, and I'm going to actually put in, you know, in a YouTube video which is around that, and if I'm going to actually suddenly put in something which is around kids merchandise, though you crawled it, it may not be the best moment. So creating rules around remarketing, which are intuitive and intelligent, I think are also important in terms of what may not be as sophisticated today, but can get to that is what I feel, so that you do market effectively. But I think being conscious of the fact that there are experiences that matter to people, right? And how do you actually take part in those experiences in a relevant manner is, I think, also very crucial.
Great. Thanks for your answer. Uma, just moving on to, of course, Suresh, you know, consumer durables was such a in-demand sort of category last year. We saw that consumers were sitting at home, they were buying appliances. Of course, Panasonic is a company that would have benefited from it. I just wanted to understand, while the lockdowns were there and there was a pent-up demand, what sort of investments have you made in technology to ensure that you reach multiple customer touch points? Could you elaborate on that and sort of ensure seamless customer service and experiences as well? Suresh, yeah.
Yeah, sure. Sunira, so I think you were absolutely right. You know, last year, pandemic caught us off guard in a sense that none of us had any idea or any learning on how to deal with a situation like this. And, you know, there was no marketing playbook also available for marketers like us, which would have helped us in navigating, you know, such an uncharted territory. However, at Panasonic, you know, what we did, we ensured that we continue to engage with our consumers. And our endeavor was to, you know, look at the consumer pain points and come up with possible solutions, you know, that we can provide as a brand while staying true to our brand ethos and our philosophy. So just to give you an example, you know, when the lockdown got announced, consumers were concerned about, you know, what will happen to my warranty. So we went ahead and we announced extended warranties. Then they were concerned about, you know, how to get my devices serviced, because, you know, service personnels were not allowed to visit homes, right? So we rolled out DIY videos. You know, we shared their financial burden also by launching, you know, cashback schemes, easy EMIs. Okay, so we tried best listening to the consumer pain points, like Mr. Bhattacharya also mentioned. Social listening was the extremely important tool at that particular time. So one of the key learnings that we got out of that exercise was that it's extremely important for you to stay relevant to your consumers, you know, continue to drive that engagement. But the most important point was that, you know, look out and explore all the possible avenues through which you can actually serve your customers. You know, so one of the, you know, learnings we took, and we ensured that this year, when again the pandemic hit us and again the lockdown started opening up, we ensured that we take care of consumer concerns when it comes to health and hygiene when they are visiting retail stores. Okay, so we ensure that our stores are completely equipped so that, you know, we take care of any safety concerns of the consumers. Second, what we did, we ensured that we have extensive lineup across all the product categories present on e-com platforms, so that, you know, there is a seamless experience that we can provide consumers, whether they want to buy it from offline or from online. Okay, third, what we did, we also helped a lot of offline retailers in digitizing their entire sales process through partnering with BeNow. You know, so we got them onboarded, we helped them, you know, digitizing their sales process. We also launched WhatsApp platform. Now, it was not a bot-based platform, it's a transitional platform wherein you can not just get to inquire about the products, we will actually assist users to buy also. Second, they can also reach out to us for any service related queries through our WhatsApp platform also. So, you know, these were the learnings that we implemented. And I would say the learning is still going on. It's not that we have understood the customer journey completely. I think it's an evolving process. The whole point is how best you can implement that and try to serve your customers and help them in, you know, enhancing their overall experience.
Sure. But were there any investments Panasonic perhaps made in the past 12 months that you're still sort of sticking to? These, of course, sound like pretty interesting initiatives. Over and above that, on the back end, anything you did?
Yeah, so actually we are doing a lot of digital transformation through adoption of CRM technologies. You know, the whole intent behind such a digital transformation is actually we wanted to give a strong consumer experience and we wanted to build a strong ecosystem of consumer experience. And this we are doing through consolidation of application on a single unified advanced platform. You know, and this also helps us in a lot of strong data analytical based CRM ecosystem. So this is what we are doing. Whenever you launch any kind of cloud solutions, it not just help you in strengthening your consumer connect, but it also helps you in driving process efficiencies. It reduces hidden cost. It mitigates your opportunity losses also. So we have been investing into such technologies and it has resulted, you know, in operational excellences also. Now, if I have to give you certain examples of operational excellence, I would say, you know, you can actually do a better management of your inventory, which eventually brings down your inventory cost. Now, for example, suppose if I have to do a spare part forecasting, you know, I can do predictive spare forecast planning and supply through a lot of AI, artificial intelligence or machine learning, which eventually brings down your cost. Your ORM processes can be, automated, which can reduce your tags. Flake claims percentage can be brought down through geo-tracking. So we have been doing that. Eventually, this benefit can be passed on to consumers in terms of cost and all. And one of the most important things is that, you know, you get a lot of product-related feedback from customers through NPS data, which eventually you can use to provide better or improved products to consumers. And it also helps you in defining the roadmap for the future. So yes, we have been investing into such technologies and we are reaping results out of that now.
Right. And Suresh, just wanted to understand how much were you doing pre-COVID?
So, to be very frank, you know, there were consumer preferences were always changing, touch points were always evolving. And, you know, we were also evolving along with that. But, you know, what this pandemic has basically done is, you know, it has accelerated the entire process of change and evolution. So, you know, we were always investing in such technologies, but it's just that, you know, now the accelerator has gone really hard in terms of, you know, implementing and ensuring that, you know, we move ahead with the times very fast. Because in last 2 years, what we have seen is that the consumer preferences, the decision journey is evolving at much faster pace than what it used to be earlier. So it's not that we've just started investing now. We were investing earlier also. It's just that the pace of investment, the pace of, you know, execution has slightly increased, keeping in mind, you know, the changing circumstances.
Great. Thanks. Just moving on to another category, which again saw a lot of consumer offtake, groceries. Arun, just coming to you, really, you know, you all have seen an explosion in demand. Clearly, we've seen consumers waiting to place orders. We've seen you've been able to fulfill orders wherever you were not able to. It's been pretty overwhelming for you all. Really, you know, how was the 2021 sort of lockdown different from 2020? There was again this sort of surge in demand when things started moving into a lockdown. What learnings did you take? What investments had you already put into place which you could really leverage? Arun, over to you.
Yeah. Thanks for this. Thanks for inviting me. I think all the other panelists are a lot more experienced than I am, but I think I'll make a valiant effort. So in terms of last year, I think all of us were caught unawares, right? I think this COVID was new to us, and we never sort of planned for a growth that we saw, right? It was just exponential; it sort of got out of proportion. But this year, I think what's happened is there have been a lot of policy changes from the government. I think that's number one, which has helped us a lot, wherein we could sort of recruit more seamlessly. We built a lot of infrastructure over the last year or so. We invested a lot in our, in our back-end infrastructure, warehouses, all of that. And I think we were far more ready this time around compared to last year. But the only glitch again was that, there's never enough supply, right? I think this year, I think again, we had some other issues. For that, I think we made some changes in terms of our in our product as well, right? I think I'm not sure if you guys have seen this, but there was a whole token-based system that we sort of utilized. It was very similar to what the vaccine system was, which we sort of brought in And our suppliers were, you know, on time. I think the supply efficiencies were there in terms of all our FMCG partners as well. I think this year, you know, we had better assortment to deliver. And I think those are the changes that we sort of made this year. I think primarily, you know, since last year, you know, we knew that we faltered somewhere. So I think our forecasting was also better. We used a lot of our data, transactional data. What we saw is, you know, ticket sizes went up rapidly last year. I think people were hoarding stock. The same thing happened this year. So we planned for that. The second thing that we also planned for is that, you know, sometime last year when COVID happened, we removed a lot of our pricing strategies, right? Our pricing policy sort of, you know, because we couldn't service the existing demand, we thought there's no point in discounting further. So, and that, you know, sort of had a effect on our retention numbers as well post-COVID, right, at the end of last year. So I think this year, you know, one of the changes that we made is we didn't want to go back on our pricing policy. I think that's something that we've maintained even through COVID, even through the worst time, something that we've maintained. And we're reaping the efforts now. We're seeing that our retention numbers are as good as or better than what we saw, you know, pre-COVID as well, say 2019, 2018 sort of numbers, wherein we are 3-4x of the size that we were in 2019. So I think these are some of the small changes that we've made. I think the key was, you know, to sort of plan for the second wave better, even though we didn't know second wave is going to happen. I think we just plan over time, you know, to sort of service demand.
Right. I think most panelists here have also spoken about how there's this shrinkage in the time taken to make decisions and take decisions, right? Because, you know, you can't think and sort of plan anymore. So for Big Basket, you know, how is that shrunk? You know, how quickly does your data and tech team work together to sort of, you know, put out these new changes? How crazy is it today compared to how it was in 2019? Because you guys don't have time to think about things and deliver groceries, at least in a category like that.
Yeah, I think sometimes we take pride in the fact that we are a super lean team, right? I think if you ask any of our partners, from our engineering team to the product team to marketing, we are super, you know, efficient. So our marketing team, for example, is around 15 people. And this includes BB Daily, you know, BB Instant, our offline stores, as well as Big Basket B2C and BB Business, because we have our own B2B vertical as well, right? And which is pretty substantial. So in that sense, I think there are pros and cons. Pros in terms of, I think, if, you know, if you see such unforeseen sort of situations, we can react much faster than maybe probably a lot of other companies, right? I think also the other fact that's helped us is most of us have been within the organization for the last 6-7 years, right from inception, right? I think that's also helped us sort of quickly turn around stuff. But in terms of cons, yes, I think, you know, we'll have to put a lot of other things on the back burner, which, you know, long-term strategies in terms of how we want to scale marketing automation. So we're not, you know, not as good as, say, an Amazon or a Flipkart in terms of personalization, hyper-personalization. You know, we still, you know, do a lot of things manually. So I think those things take a backseat. But in terms of churning things out quickly, I think, you know, lean teams help. So that's how we sort of manage.
Right. We talk about hyper-personalization, but is that something you will consider now that sort of that first two waves are sort of receding? Is that something you will focus on going forward?
Yeah, I think we will have to. We do that to an extent, meaning we don't have probably the tools for it. But, you know, we know what our customer purchase patterns are, customer behaviors are, how they interact with our products. So all those data is available with us. So we create a lot of campaigns, segments, all that around this data, but, you know, albeit in a more manual fashion. But we use data, for example, for real-time hyper-personalization. You know, we have something called the Smart Basket, you know, which is sort of predicts what you would need the next week or the next fortnight based on your past purchase behavior. I think that's something that we are keen to push, and that's super useful for a consumer. And that's something that we've been pushing for a long time now. I think it's time for us to move on to, you know, other more evolved quote-unquote models that are out there, which we will, I think, eventually.
Great, thanks. Just moving on to Pratap. You know, again, apparel retail has seen again a very challenging year. One key concern or one sort of thing one would imagine is, how do you all then plan and forecast? You know, how do you manage inventory? Because you don't know when the next lockdown is coming. Are you sort of reading data better? Are you sort of learning as you go? What are you doing at the back end, even globally and in India? Because one doesn't know when the next store is shut. So how's your demand planning, forecasting, inventory management going really?
If I look at 2020, that was once in a lifetime kind of scenario, at least for our generation. And your April and May months were very bad. you know, it was an absolute lockdown. Nothing could move on. Fortunately for us, 2019 and a little earlier to that, we had started looking more on the online front, you know, digital commerce, the social selling and all. Fortunately, since some part of the work had already been done in 2019, we could manage to carry that work in April and May, which were the lean periods. And while 2 months of no activity, we had a lot of time to think on the supply chain aspect, which is a key for us in the apparel industry. And being in fast fashion, it is all the more important to keep the product, you know, in sync with the consumer experience and the fashion trends. So what we did was, the moment the lockdown opened, we went into a regional kind of concept from the SCM perspective. So that was one part on the physical side of the decision making. And the other part was the backend infra was being upgraded. And we went into something called, you know, single view of inventory. And we plugged in Unicommerce and all. And so that the same inventory is visible and available for all the touch points where the customers come in. And of course, the omnification is one big piece. And the issue was the production was nil. So whatever stock was available with us was to be, you know, cataloged and presented in a manner where the freshness is being maintained. So omnification and the regional diversification was, you know, something that has helped us navigate through this. Now, over the period, what we realized was India being a large country with equally large population, you know, other than China, I believe nobody has that kind of population that we have. And we were aware of the factual circumstances, you know, in terms of the health standards, the vaccination, you know, the possibility of the vaccine to come in. And then even if the vaccine is available, how much time will it happen to inoculate the entire population or at least, you know, 70 to 80%. So we started focusing more on the digital side, you know, and on the backend side also, we have deployed a lot of smaller initiatives, which takes care of the inventory management in a better way, you know, keeping our inventory a little lean because we are a fashion company. So at the same time, we need to keep on churning, you know, fresh products for the consumer. And, you know, WhatsApp commerce and omnification, these were the two things that we had put in. And if I look at the second wave of COVID, we don't know which state, which city would be under lockdown and for how many days or weeks. So omnification of store is another area that we have got into. So wherever you are, order to delivery, we are trying to crunch that timeline. So if Maharashtra is closed for now, say for example, we have Rajasthan open. So we have regional, you know, depot or a store available in Rajasthan from where the customer or the consumer can be fulfilled. So these are the smaller initiatives that we took and manage the both sides of the business. Yes, please.
Right. And you think there is still more work left to be done? Do you think there are more innovations you could look at going forward? Or, I mean, are there some gaps you want to plug? Or is it work in progress still?
Sure. Sunira, see, the consumer behavior has changed drastically. If you look at consumers, especially from our perspective, you know, work from home kind of wear range, loungewear, these things have come into vogue. And with safety, you know, fears or I will say concerns in the consumer mind, the offline channel is a little disturbed channel. And the best way to approach a consumer nowadays is, I believe, approach them digitally. Of course, we don't want to encroach upon the privacy part. Creating a personalized experience for them, curating range for a specific set of customers, and then deploying it all across. So if the consumer is comfortable, of course, the offline stores are available. But we would like to, you know, penetrate through the online medium only nowadays.
Right. Just curious, perhaps our panelists and audience is curious too, how much would e-commerce be for bestseller in India? What percentage would be coming from online?
See, currently, if you look at it, it has crossed the threshold of 30.
That's significant.
The very reason is, if you look at geographically, you have different states, getting into lockdowns frequently. And then the only medium that is available is online medium, because in many of these states, besides the essential, non-essential items were also being allowed to be, couriered and shared. Maharashtra is an exceptional scenario where there was a point of time where, non-essentials were completely blocked. But now it is also going to a better scenario. So that's the overall scenario as of now. Yes.
Great. Super. Thanks. I think we picked up a lot of buzzwords from this round. Lean inventory, lean teams, shorter cycles. So clearly a lot of sort of changes and learnings for retail. Mr. Yashas, just coming back to you, could you share with us some sort of case studies on how retailers and CPG companies have used data effectively to sort of personalize shopping experience, especially in an omni-channel setting? Like, what have you done, of course, in 2021 and last year as well? Mr. Yashas?
Sure, Sunira. Thank you for asking that. As a technology provider, I mean, it's certainly a cause for pride to talk about, our customers and what they have done. There's a few things that I wanted to sort of touch on before I get to the use cases, from what the other panelists actually spoke of. I think Ms. Uma spoke about the fact that you need to differentiate the type of transaction, right? I mean, we use e-commerce and digital for a whole variety of purposes. There are differences in the way you approach a low value, high volume transaction versus a high value, low volume transaction, right? And the extent of personalization that you actually offer here, the degree to which you may be able to deploy a technology such as an AI or a chatbot, video or voice, to automate something like grocery shopping versus, somebody actually wanting to buy a high value, piece of jewelry or something like that. And then I think we also had Mr. Swaroop talk about innovation and the need to continually, roll out a catalog of products that keeps in tune with, the buying preferences in a sector such as apparel, right? The use cases that we had, Sunira, were not just restricted to the use of data. There were different problems that customers actually solved, right? I'll give you a few examples, both in the domestic context as well as internationally. Praxis is one of our customers that actually wanted to create an omni-channel experience based on a single view of the customer being available to all the different people that engage with the customer, right? So it was about building a centralized customer profile, and they choose to use technology to do that. In the case of Puma India, they actually wanted to operationalize a mobile site buying experience, which was specifically linked to, shortening the cycle time of decisions for customers who are actually, producing their products on that mobile, buying experience. And then you had a customer like ELF, which is actually a cosmetics company in the US, that had operated traditionally about a 15-year period with a brick and mortar operation. But in 2019, they took the decision to move, all digital. They shut down all their physical stores and went completely digital. So we supported them through that, process of digitization, and an important component of that was actually customer loyalty and being able to tap into the loyalty element of your customer profile, right? And how you personalize your experience, your buying experience with customers tied to that element of loyalty. And then I think the other aspect that Mr. Sirish spoke about was the evolution of learning, right? How do you actually continually learn from the aspect of buying? Let's say you expand into a new market. We had OLX as a customer that actually wanted to expand their operations and the digital channels that they had available to 45 different countries. So for them, it was being able to learn from what they had done in country and then be able to leverage some of those best practices across countries, right? So these are some of the customers and some of the use cases that we came across in this past year, maybe a little over this past year as well, not just specific to COVID alone. The last part of it, Sunira, is when you talk about data, there is the aspect of how you can optimize what you do internally in order to improve your efficiencies, in order to improve your productivity levels, in order to make sure that you're catering to something as fundamental as employee safety. in a COVID-like period, right? Can I use my artificial intelligence and data to look at the internal view of how I run my business? And similarly, can I now use AI, which is more talked about, of course, in the retail and CPG context, which is around the customer profile, right? One other element that, as a technology provider, we see across is that digitization is no longer something that's happening in a particular sector, right? We've had it happening across sectors. So our customers now not only have the ability to learn from their peers within the own industry, but also look at some best practice and innovation in companies that are in a completely different sector. So all these put together are what has been some of the learnings that we've had in working with our customers over the last year or so.
Right. But sir, just wanted to understand, what are the challenges companies can also face? Clearly, COVID has been sort of a shock for companies, and mostly companies can be resistant to tech adoption, especially the larger traditional companies. So what are the challenges? Is it sort of easier to adopt now because the ecosystem is more developed? What do you think?
I think the innovation in terms of the tools and technologies available has definitely accelerated in this period. So companies, our customers have a lot of choices in terms of where they want to start. There are homegrown solutions that are available. There are off-the-shelf solutions that are available. But I think one important aspect of that, Sunira, is not just taking a short-term view of the problem you want to solve, let's say in the next 3 months or 6 months, but also, what are you building towards, in a three-year term? Because you want to take a, slightly longer term view of the business as well. I've mentioned this before in other forums as well, and I'd like to say that fundamentally, if you're making your business decisions driven by what your customers expect of you, and you put your customer at the center of, everything you do in terms of technology or in terms of, process, in my experience, at least, having been a consultant in the IT industry for over 20 plus years, I've seen a greater degree of success with technology, and what technology is able to do for you. If you can ask that fundamental question, is this going to change the way my customer, perceives my brand? Is this going to change the way my customer is able to actually engage with me? And does it create a more positive experience overall for them?
Great. Thank you, sir. Joydeep, coming to you, and I think my question would be probably more broad because you sort of look at the entire gamut of the whole consumer business. Mr. Yashas earlier mentioned that digital channels will now be a P&L for companies. Are you seeing companies sort of take and sort of go into 2021 with that approach, be it a smaller CPG company or be it retail? Where is the sort of mindset currently? Like, are they looking at digital as a separate P&L, digital channels for that matter?
The smart ones definitely are, Sunira, but is that a widespread infection as yet? I suspect not. So we've seen, especially, let's say, in the fashion, lifestyle, beauty, cosmetics categories, good players are now looking at digital not just as a channel, but as a full business, right? So completely separate teams. And partly because the demand generation part is easier, it's the supply chain that kills you. So making sure that the supply chain that's needed for a digital business, is set up. So we I think back to even Suresh's, sector as well, consumer durables players are again kind of beginning to treat, digital as a separate business as opposed to just another channel. There are lots of, issues, conflict with offline, so on and so forth. But I think you need to take a hard call and say, I'm going to run this separately. I'm going to keep it linked, but separate from the mothership, and make sure that this business kind of works. So that's what we've seen. CPG, not as yet. I would say that even the best, and whether it's a Hindustan Unilever or Mondi's, I mean, a lot of them are still treating it as another channel. I think the fact that it's a business with maybe a different assortment, very different budgets. So people have started putting the talent, etc. But Sunaira, not yet as a separate business. P&Ls, yes, but that's still, just having a P&L doesn't capture the essence of what separate business is.
Right. So, for retail now, sort of going forward for retail overall, to keep reinventing itself, what kind of tech-led strategies can prove most beneficial for companies in India?
There is a long list, and I heard all my co-panelists kind of, name a bunch. I would say that, going back to what Yash said, I think there is a lot to be done. I think the biggest challenge that I've seen my clients, grapple with is how do I really prioritize and sequence stuff, right? There's so much I can do. And frankly, despite all valiant efforts over the past few years, people are still at very early stages of, you know, using technology to drive their businesses. So one, I think, is in one of, you know, prioritization. And, I, you know, the framework that I've seen many good players use is, you know, what do I need to do now? What do I need to do next? And what's beyond? A lot of the supply chain solutions are, you know, things that you need to do now. You know, better technologies, whether it's, let's say, what Uma mentioned in terms of conversational commerce, live streaming, I think come into the next kind of box, along with things like dynamic pricing. I think then you move on to, you know, what's beyond. And I think, you know, while personalization, one must, you know, everything might need to start now. But how do I get to much better use of first-party data personalization to make a scale impact as opposed to seeding experiments? I think that kind of falls in the beyond. So I think that's where, you know, we see, you know, how do I get the right prioritization, you know, going is the biggest challenge that I see, you know, the C-suite kind of, you know, struggle with.
Right. Thanks. You know, Uma, moving on to you, just wanted to understand clearly for retailers like yourself and even perhaps for a Panasonic and Bestseller, you all have to now reach customers across multiple consumer touch points, right? But, you know, once, let's say, the wave subsides, once there's sort of a ample vaccination that's taken place, how many of these touch points will actually, you know, stick around? The WhatsApp shopping, the virtual aisles, stuff like that, sort of which were the buzzwords last year. How much of it is likely to stick around?
Yeah, it's difficult to really predict what will happen. But I think that there will be a plethora of channels which will exist, right? I think it's more important to identify the use of that channel, which is critical for your business, right? And what is it that you want to intend to do with it? So is it that WhatsApp is going to become your service channel? And if you want it dedicated to your service channel, then I think that's a strategy that you deploy with that intention, knowing fully well that your customers would probably prefer that. They want to be able to see the status of their order, the status of the shipment, they want to see payment over there, etc. And therefore, that becomes a channel of preference as a service channel, right? Now, if conversational commerce is not going to be a preferred, I mean, you know, you will see a lot of things which will come into place. So, for example, if families are not going to be actually going to stores as much, right, even in the future, because there will be conditioning as well, which takes place, behaviors will change. But maybe you want to do this online. Now, how you start integrating Alexa into your strategy or voice, you know, bots into your strategy for probably joint shopping on a television screen. I think there will have to be strategies which will evolve. I don't think that channels are going to vanish as such. There will be a plethora of channels that will continue to exist, but they will start becoming sharper in terms of what they're more relevant for customers as things start settling down. And customers will realize that one channel serves a purpose better than the other. But I think it's more critical for you to design that channel and the experience with a very clear proposition that you have in mind for the consumers and create awareness. So, for example, you know, in the past, we used to see Twitter was a very popular complaint channel, right, where people wanted their complaint to be heard. And because it was a visible complaint, and then obviously, you know, retailers or any brand actually reacted much faster because it was out in the open. Right. And therefore, customers actually did that. But brands set up like ASOS had ASOS Help and ASOS, which was a brand channel, which they segregated so that they know that they're going to address Twitter as a service channel very markedly through a separate channel. So I think those are the kind of strategies that one would have to put into place. And this is the best time to learn that as to what are people preferring different channels for, and then shape your strategy accordingly.
Super, but could you give us a number, like for the overall retail industry, for fashion, for instance, you know, is there more touch and feel that people would want, or they're comfortable shopping online now because perhaps people know their sizes and it fits more and you're offering better solutions to them. Is there a number to how much digital will bring in?
I think digital will grow, but it's not going to be 100%. And you will see digital integration in the store as a very big strategy. In terms of how people use the brand's application to shop better, conveniently, and you know, faster, and you know, maybe probably more exciting in the store. I think at present, if you are at, hovering at about 10%, let's say as an overall industry, maybe you go to 30-40%. But that would be just crystal ball gazing without really any input that is available to us. But that's just my calculated assumption, I would say.
Right. And are you sort of turning more intuitive when it comes to personalization? Are you sort of, you know, do you have more features on your shopping site, on your platform?
Yeah, I think personalization will again merge real world as well as this. So you will see a lot of that, which is taking place where, because you enter a store, you're using the mobile application, the staff can actually help you better. You could ping a staff through the application when you need help, or you can be actually empowered through the app itself. Reduce assistance and contact through the staff. So there will be many such experiences which will actually come up, which are much more personalized using digital through your D2C app.
Super. Thank you. Sirish, moving on to you, you know, there was, of course, while smaller appliances have and mobile phones have sort of led the growth for e-commerce in India, at least in the initial days, larger appliances is where the, you know, it's people still need to go offline. So what are you doing when it comes to consumer touch points? You know, how are you letting the consumer experience your product online versus how they can see it offline for certain categories like for Panasonic?
So Sunita, there is no doubt that today technology has enabled consumers to get whatever they want, whenever they want, and however they want it. You know, so it's imperative for brands to understand this modern day consumer and engage with them and ensure that you provide best-in-class experience across all the touch points. Now, specifically, if I have to talk about consumer durables, and it has been mentioned by Mr. Bhattacharya and Mr. Vyasa also, that, you know, the consumer journey when it comes to consumer durable is extremely non-linear. It's not at all linear. You know, even certain data points says that when a consumer is planning to buy any consumer durable device, they take minimum 2 to 3 weeks of time before making up their mind on which brand or which product of choice that they want to buy. During this, you know, search or research period, they are experiencing multiple touch points. You know, we have seen consumers walking into a store. Though I can say currently, you know, the number of walk-ins have gone down, but it's that more serious buyers are actually walking into a store. You know, you see less of window shoppers actually coming to the store. So you go to the store. Most of the research is primarily happening on digital platform. So people go to e-com platforms to validate their decisions through reviews, through ratings. They go to YouTube channels to, you know, look at the unboxing videos, the review videos and all. You know, so as a brand, it's extremely important for you to be present across all the touch points. So I cannot just say that a brand can survive today by being present on only on offline channel or vice versa. The onus is on the brand to ensure that, you know, you provide right content, you have right set of tools across all these touch points available for consumers, which can eventually help them in making that informed decision. So if a consumer is walking into a store, you need to have right set of QSMs, you need to have a right spiel for that sales guy, which can highlight the differentiating factors. You know, if someone is coming to e-com platform, you need to ensure that you have right set of content listed out, product videos, right kind of visuals available. Likewise, you need to seed relevant review videos, unboxing videos, usage and application driven videos on YouTube platform. So during the entire decision journey, you need to, you know, handhold consumer so that they can make the most informed decision. I think that's the, you know, way brands need to work.
Great, super. So we will see more innovations coming from Panasonic within this year.
Of course.
Great. Arun, just coming to you, you know, how do you all solve challenges when it comes to, let's say, express deliveries and, you know, promising shorter durations? Because the whole grocery space, of course, has gotten more competitive. Companies want to reach consumers. They want to sort of, you know, compete with the Kirana Walas. So, you know, how do you work around things like that, you know, express deliveries and promising certain, you know, benefits to shoppers? Will we see more of that coming from your company this year?
See, I can divulge a few things, but the way we're looking at things is, see, I think the next set of users for grocery will be value first users. I think you're seeing that clearly now with JioMart coming in and Grofers and all these guys sort of establishing their presence across markets. I think value first will be the next leg of growth for grocery as a business. And we've done a lot of surveys to sort of validate this, you know, the last 6-8 months. I think for us, one of the key factors will be, you know, pricing strategy will be something that we want to play with for the next year or so. I think the second part is, you know, through our surveys, through a lot of customer connect programs, we figured that, you know, outside tier ones and within tier ones also very small pockets, I don't think customers need groceries, you know, instantly. Because people are okay if it's delivered in 6 hours, 5 to 6 hours. I don't think this half an hour, 1 hour is something that, you know, it's not food, right? So you don't need anything that urgently as say half an hour or an hour. But having said that, you know, Swiggy, Dunzo's and all these companies have built a market for, you know, they've sort of built a new sort of behavior with the metro urban users. So we'll have to figure out how to sort of get into that space, provided unit economics work well. We have the density to service such a quick delivery and things like that. But again, it's up for grabs and we're still working on it.
Right, super. Of course, you're saying there are some things you can't divulge. So we will look forward to those announcements as well.
Yeah.
Super. Just moving on, you know, just wanted to understand for bestseller, really, you know, how are you viewing customer sentiment right now? And what do you think that industry leaders, industry sort of key stakeholders should prioritize in the next 3 months, Pratap, as far as business continuity is concerned? Pratap, over to you.
Again, the market is very volatile looking at the current COVID scenario. And a lot of state governments are talking about, you know, the third wave. Now that creates a concern in the general population, and that directly impacts us as a company, as a fashion brand, because apparel is not a necessity item. It is more to do with an up kind of sentiments where the consumer needs it for some kind of what you call it, a party kind of scenario, a happy moment, or probably relax requirements at home. And so for next 3 months, if you ask me, the idea is about looking at omnification, and the biggest part that impacts the consumer is price parity. Online, in some way, if I look at partner business, it was more on the discounting front that they were luring in the enticing the consumer. However, now online being the main channel, one of the main channels, the price parity is equally important along with availability of the fresh products, you know, the fashion products, the home delivery, you know, store pickup, and all similar concepts will come into the vogue. Wherever possible, the consumer may want to go online, browse it, and may still pick up from the store to have that look and feel kind of scenario. So for next 3 months, we are still continuing to focus on the digital piece, whereby the consumer has a visible experience. And if possible, they can always visit the nearby store and take up the product from there. So tech piece is something that is highest priority, both from the back end perspective as well as the front end perspective. Our captive web pages, we are continuously working on the experience part, trying to reach out to them. In terms of better catalogs and making you know, reach out to them in more specifics being basis their buying pattern. And like Uma said, WhatsApp selling and reach out would be the key initiatives that we will like to continue for next 3 months, or rather I will say next 6 months time. That's the focus. Yes, please.
Right. Great. So what I'll do is, you know, I'll just pick up a few audience questions and I'll also do a quick round of sort of closures with all of you in sense. What are the top 2-3 trends you all see which will really play out in the market in the next 6 months within India? And in fact, even things that you're all doing. So just to go back to you, Shirish, you know, what will we see coming from Panasonic? And also we have a question for you, Shirish. Somebody asked whether WhatsApp sales are big for you and whether you get a lot of orders via WhatsApp.
We have recently started this particular platform and we have seen certain tractions. So if I have to tell you in terms of the queries that we are generating currently on a daily basis, the numbers are probably in hundreds, but on a monthly basis, if I look at currently just the queries that are getting generated are in thousands. So it's a new platform for users also, but it's gaining traction. And the best part about it is it can be highly personalized also. So in the long run, I would see that it will gain, you know, momentum, and it will gain certain attention in consumers' mind.
Right, and do these queries translate into sales as well for you?
Yes. So currently, we don't have a transactional-based, you know, platform wherein you can directly make the payment through WhatsApp. But what we are doing is, once a consumer reaches out to us, we approach them then through offline mediums, and that's how we try to close it. But very soon, we'll be bringing a complete end-to-end WhatsApp-based sales platform also.
Interesting. So that's something we could look forward from Panasonic. Absolutely. In the next Right. And this will, of course, include, you know, I mean, will this be an offline or online integration, or will this be a separate sales channel completely?
No, it's going to be O2O, offline to online. Yes.
Sure. Interesting. Anything else we could look forward from Panasonic in the next 6 months? Something you're watching in the market?
Okay. So one thing that we are currently working on is we have already launched the virtual demo platform wherein, you know, you can come to our website, you can book an appointment, and you don't have to visit a store. One of our sales assistants will actually do a complete demo of a product that you are interested in through a video call, wherein the product will be demonstrated to you just in a manner that you go and see it in the store. The only difference will be you might not be able to touch it, but other than that, you can actually experience each and every aspect of it. So we are rolling that out also. So this is also keeping in mind the new consumer trends, wherein those who are not willing to walk out of homes still are not deprived from, you know, detailing out the product that they plan to buy. So this is something that we are rolling out.
Super. Arun, I know you want to not discuss a lot of these things, but since most of us perhaps have shop groceries online or beginning to shop groceries online, anything we could look forward from Big Basket or any sort of, you know, operation that you might be looking at sort of bettering your marketing, anything you'd like to share?
Yeah, very tricky questions to answer. But I think one thing that we're certain about, like I said, I think the next set of customers will be value first. And also from, you know, the proliferation of internet and mobile phones and all that, I think it's taken some time, but COVID sort of hastened the process. I think the next leg of growth will also come from tier two, tier three markets for us. So we can, you know, you can look forward to something in that space. And we're also trying to sort of leverage our backend infrastructure to, you know, deepen our presence in the B2B side of things as well. I think that's also sort of picking up some scale now. I think these are the two major things. The rest, I think, like I said, you know, it's too early for me to comment.
Right. And when you say value first, you mean those are people who, those are shoppers who what, look for discounts and sort of bulk buying and what?
I think the early adopters are more convenience seeking, you know, large assortment. You know, I don't think they had like a lot of issues with the price points. I think the next set will be, you know, smaller assortment, you know, which is more consumer goods, highly elastic products, commodities. I think those are the set of users that we'll have to go after, and their pricing is a key factor. And, you know, shorter assortment, delivery time sort of, you know, is not a major barrier for purchase, right? So I think these are the 2-3 factors that we sort of have seen through our surveys.
Right. Interesting. Thanks. Uma, just to sort of pick from one of your points earlier, just to clarify, you mentioned 100% of your spends are now on digital. Do you mean all your marketing spends are now on digital? Is that what you meant?
Yes, that's right. Yes,
okay, so you mean that like you've shifted all advertising spends to digital. So no more billboards and no more newspaper ads for you?
No, none. They're only on digital, yes.
And when did that happen for you, for ShopStop?
For Shopper Stop, I think it happened just when COVID hit. So we were already veering much more towards digital. But since lockdown, we've been 100% digital.
Right.
So we would have been at 50% of digital, but now we are almost 100% digital.
Right. And what sort of changes have you seen with that in terms of, you know, new customer acquisition or even sort of targeted influencer outreach, stuff like that? Are you seeing more engagement happening for the brand?
I think firstly, more measurability. You know, where you can actually look at and see what is happening to your acquisition very clearly. Ability to measure customer lifetime value much better across the marketing funnel and look at, you know, where you're delivering. So I think that's the second piece which is there. In terms of really looking at engagement, I would say yes, influencer marketing and many other channels which are on digital channels do allow for engagement which is more conversational and two-way in nature. So we have seen very good impact in actually getting UGC from participants on digital, which has been a prominent approach to many of our campaigns in terms of getting, for example, makeup experts to take part or consumers to take part in different stories. So that has been a very positive outcome, which has improved the engagement on the digital channels as well, for sure. And I think we are seeing more and more retention for sure. So we do find with the use of digital channels, our repeat share has been constantly growing as well on online specifically.
Interesting. Thanks, Uma. Just to wrap this session up, Pratap, just sort of your last thoughts. It's 30% for you already e-commerce. How much do you think it will grow to in the next 2-3 years? I know it's crystal ball gazing. Let's also assume once markets open up, things people could want to go back to stores in droves. But what are your
thoughts? Yes, you are right, Sunira. There would be a correction. If I say 30%, this is because of limitations that this pandemic has imposed on people. So naturally, it will come down below 30%, because when I talk about omnification, it talks about, you know, stores also as a fulfillment centers. So that store experience will come back, the brick and mortar will come back. And India being a large size population country, we would still love to go out to a mall or to a high street to have that kind of experience. You know, shopping for Indians, I believe, is not about buying a product. It's the experience of the product as well as the entire experience of moving, you know, in the vicinity of various shops and all. And yes, 30%, I believe it would be around 24-25%, and it will become stable. And this online thing will be so intertwined with the offline channel that from a P&L perspective, yes, we can discuss what kind of sales we are extracting from an online.
Interesting. Thanks. Just to wrap this session up, Mr. Yashas, any sort of, last thoughts that you might have to conclude the session?
Sunira, I think a couple of themes that I picked up from the other panelists that we hear. One is, you know, there's no one size fits all. So I think we need to keep that in mind. The asks from white goods, consumer goods organization are very, very distinct to a retail and apparel versus, let's say, food delivery or grocery delivery, organization, right? So I think that is the start point of defining what sort of a customer journey you're actually expected to support as a technology provider, and what are some of the changes that your customer expects in this manner. The other aspect I think is very, very relevant in the Indian context. Mr. Swaroop was mentioning that before he dropped off, but the whole online to offline and offline to online will continue, right? I mean, buying and shopping is definitely an experience, and that experience spans across the whole purchase cycle, which may actually start with you, during your research before you buy something, before you buy a product, to when you conclude the purchase, to the touch points that you actually go through. And I think the importance of social was mentioned a few times. We rely very heavily on our networks to actually, assess the brand that we are engaging with as a customer, right? So being able to build that brand and the picture of your brand across the whole customer interaction life cycle is a very, very important part of how you end up differentiating yourself as a retailer or, as an organization that's engaging with customers in the digital world. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, sir. Joydeep, can we have you back? You perhaps gave us sort of broad overview of the sector just at the beginning of the conversation, but any last leaving thoughts sort of conclude what everybody's saying? Directionally, looks like everybody's sort of in the same direction, be it traditional businesses or non-traditional businesses or consumer durables. Any conclusive thoughts?
No, I think everybody's kind of, said what's there to be said. I mean, a couple of things that we keep reminding ourselves of is that, ultimately all retail is omni, channel. So it doesn't matter whether digital or, so as consumer journeys will probably change faster than what individual retailers can. And the second thing I would just, argue is that, retail's always been a difficult industry to operate in. It's been kind of challenged in terms of, profits, etc. Some of, these changes in channels and consumers, impose even higher costs, as Arun was outlining. And then I do therefore think that the next, 2 to 5 years will more differentiate winners from losers going forward, right? If there is, we can all talk about the industry changing, but, let's understand the impact on each of us is that it's actually going to separate out the good from the bad, far more quickly than it has in the past. It's going to be unforgiving. So I think that those are the kind of, two takeaways that I would have.
Super. Sounds good. I think we've sort of overshot the time, so I'll perhaps stop. I have lots more questions, which I can perhaps discuss with all of you later. But thank you so much for joining us. I think we've also answered some audience questions. And if there's anything else, Mr. Pratap is saying that he got disconnected. If there's anything else, we'll of course reach out to you. And thank you all for being part of this panel. Lovely conversation. And I hope you all have a good day ahead.